Hi, I'm Dr. Manimala Selvi Naiker. I'm a consultant histopathologist and statistician, and my area of interest is in meta-analysis. This is an EBM video about drug efficiency and efficacy. For this video, I'm going to refer to the FDA, which is the Food and Drug Agency of the US, and I'm also going to refer to the word Congress, and by Congress, I mean the House of Representatives, the Senate, and the President of the United States. So Congress means all three, right? The reason why I am going to refer to these entities is because drug efficacy is not just a medical concept, it also has a legal basis to it. Now, prior to 1962, all FDA had to do was to ensure that food or drug sold need to be safe. They did not have to worry about efficacy. But this led to problems because drug manufacturers could just sell sugar water and claim that it could cure cancer. Now, what is the problem with this? Right? Now, this means that cancer patients would be spending huge amounts of money buying this drug, and they will get cheated, so that is fraud. Number two, cancer patients need anti-cancer therapy, without which they may die. So, by giving them sugar water, you are in effect hastening their death, right? So, it was both dangerous and fraudulent not to have efficacy statements for drug. So, this was Congress's directive to FDA via this amendment. Now, this amendment is formally known as the Kefauver-Harris Amendment of 1962 to the Federal Food and Drug and Cosmetic Act, right? Now, what did it require? It required that drug manufacturers to prove scientifically that a medication was not only safe but effective. Okay, what were Congress's exact directive? It directed FDA not to approve drugs due to lack of substantial evidence of efficacy. Now, if you just type in these words, right? Lack of substantial evidence of efficacy. Now, this is what FDA uses to reject or to deregister approved drugs, right? Because prior to that, drugs were just approved without efficacy statement. So let's look at these words again clearly. Lack of substantial evidence of efficacy. It does not say lack of evidence of substantial efficacy. So what FDA has to do is to make sure that the evidence for efficacy is substantial. The efficacy itself need not be substantial. In fact, the efficacy can be small or modest, but it must exist, and the evidence that it exists must be substantial. That means a drug with 1% efficacy can also be approved. A drug with 20% efficacy can also be approved. Now, Congress went one step further. They said that even if that particular illness has already got a drug with 20% efficacy, and the new drug has got an efficacy less than that, that drug can also be approved, right? Now, why would Congress want to approve a new drug with 1% efficacy when there's already a drug with 20% efficacy in the market? Now, Congress knows that there are very few drugs which are effective in everyone. Right? There are very few blockbuster drugs. I think the last blockbuster drug that we had was insulin, penicillin, and a few antibiotics. Most drugs are very modest in efficacy, and they only are efficacious in some people. So, for example, if I've got diabetes, the doctor might give me the drug which is efficacious in 20% of the population. Now, that drug may not work on me. So the doctor may then try the drug which has only got 1% efficacy in drug trials. Now that drug may work on me. So because Congress knows this, so they said that as long as you can prove the drug is efficacious, it can be passed. Now what are the safeguards that Congress put in place? they directed FDA to oversee the advertisement of drugs. So let's say there is an anti-diabetic drug with 1% efficacy, then the advertisement can only claim that 1% efficacy. That means you cannot claim anything in the advert that you cannot prove, right? So that is what Congress wanted. They did not say that only the most efficacious drugs must be in circulation. They say that all efficacious drugs can be in circulation, but the claim must match the scientific data. So no false claims. Right? So that was what Congress directed FDA to do. To check on the claim and allow only that claim to be advertised. So it's basically about being truthful. Now, that is Congress's directive. So what? How does FDA operationalize this directive, right? So FDA operationalized it in the main. So in general, FDA operationalized it by requiring the drug manufacturer to show he only needs to show two well-controlled study, well-designed and well-controlled studies showing efficacy, right? And they set out these rules in a series of documents known as the ICH documents. I think it stands for International Committee on Harmonization. And the specific documents that tells you that how to go about conducting these studies is known as the ICH E9. Now, this ICH E9 document is so sorely misunderstood by doctors, right? What does this document set out? It basically says that if you have a new drug and you want to make a claim, right, that this drug has got 10% efficacy against a placebo, then you have got to design the study and get a sample size to show exactly that claim. If you want to make a claim that your drug is more efficacious than the current drug or a rival drug, then you have to design a study to show that your drug is more efficacious than the rival drug. If you want to say it's 10%, then it's 10% efficacy. So basically, you have to design a study that is going to match your advertisement, right? So most companies will design a study which shows at least 5, 10, 15% efficacy, because they know if their product only shows 1% efficacy, FDA may approve that product. But then the money that they spent in marketing is going to be wasted. That's why you find that many drug companies, if the drug doesn't match their projected marketing strategy, they will withdraw the drug, right? FDA doesn't disapprove the drug. They themselves will withdraw the drug, right? Now, why does FDA choose things like 95% confidence interval or 80% power? There is no right or wrong. There is no magic to these statements, okay? These were the quantities used by industrial statistician. It was actually popularized by a pair of industrial statistician known as the Neyman Pearson team. Okay, anyone who studies statistics will be very familiar with this thing. They were in the early part of the 20th century. They were factory statisticians and they liked to use 95% confidence, p-value of 0.05, and power of 80. So it has just felt that this was fair. It was not right, it was not wrong, it was just fair, because FDA also has to make sure that, you know, you don't push the manufacturer so much that the cost of the drug goes up. That will not be fair to patient. Number two, you cannot delay the drug's release also, because there are many patients in whom the current drugs are not effective, so they are waiting for this new drug. So these kinds of rules are basically designed to be fair, not right, not wrong, fair. And as far as possible, they do the job, right? So this ICH E9 document is so sorely misunderstood that people use it to do all kinds of randomized control trials, and they end up with very low quality trials. So how do we look at efficacy? Now, if you look at a meta-analysis, please don't worry about the calculations, and most of these calculations don't fit medicine, right? I usually just tend to look at the forest plot first. Now, if a drug consistently favors, so if the forest plot consistently favors the drug. It might be a small favor, it might be a weak favor, but it consistently favors the drug, then that drug is efficacious. It's a low level efficacious drug, but it is efficacious, right? Now, if the efficacy statement of the drug sometimes is positive, sometimes is negative, then this is probably due to chance, or it just favors a it just works in a particular population. So there is a science and an art to looking at these forest plots, right? So the thing that I wanted to highlight here is that doctors need to understand the meaning of efficacy, right? And what Congress intended by asking for efficacy statements on drug labels. And I think in this pandemic situation where so many doctors are going around making so many claims and counterclaims, I think it would be a good idea for if the legal profession would step in and help explain this KH amendment of 1962 to our doctors, right? I think it'll go a long way in preventing all these confusing statements. Thank you very much for listening.